and also to our director, the media, and all the participants. I request participants to kindly join for a photograph and then followed by high tea. Thank you.
You'll keep on coming and encouraging all my young friends here. I request.
Thank you, sir. Friends, we are happy to announce that this morning, Madam, while inaugurating the two-day workshop on boards, and she has also released the book written by our faculty, our director, and our faculty colleagues, Professor R.K. Mishra, Indrashekhar Yadav, Pawan Kumar, Swayampra Mishra, and J. Kiranve. Big round of applause for all these people. And this is a very important area in banking, risk management. So IP has got a research center on risk management and various other centers. We thank Madam for taking time to inaugurate this book also. Now I request Madam to address the students. Thank you.
Dr. R.K. Mishra, Director, IP, faculty members, and very dear students, good afternoon to all of you. I came in with a purpose to talk on her role in the boardroom, and Mishraji brought me here in the midst of students, and it's a very precious moment for me because, one, I wish I were your age to sit in this auditorium, study in this beautiful campus. It is a very captivating campus. Excellent learning environment and excellent faculty, and what more you need. So it is a point of envy for me seeing all of you, and I'm sure each one of you is enjoying your academia, you are enjoying the entire campus and enjoying the city of Hyderabad. So all of you are in the management program. I think after completing your graduation, post-graduation, you have stepped into the management curriculum, and this is a value addition to whatever you have done, right? And today's children, you ask them, what do you want to be? Everybody says, I want to be MBA. You know, MBA from where? Yes, they list out a lot of management schools, and each one wise to get in a place, and I'm sure through the selection process, you have all got into a very good institute. This is a part of your aspiration.
To become management graduates, add value to whatever you have done and then move forward in life. Pick up, yes, everybody wants to have the best of jobs, the best of placements, best of salaries, right? Yes or no? You all want. But I would say that is not end in everything. Having qualified, you have to be driven by an aspiration. There is a world of difference between ambition and aspiration. So in that context, whatever you want to be, ultimately, you have to drive it passionately. What is most important is, one part is your academic qualifications, which will stand by you very well, but the other part is, whatever you choose to do, do it passionately. Passion should be, it should be a fire in you. You want to set up a 5-star hotel, or you want to work as an executive, you want to start a channel, whatever you want to do, ultimately the key to success is going to be the passion that drives you. So the first lesson for us will be the best of things that we take away from IPE campus and ignite it with the passion. I think the results are fantastic. This is a world of, you know, driven by technology, driven by, it's a digital era that we are all living in. There is an information explosion happening. How many of you are not on Facebook? How many of you are not on Facebook? In this crowd, I can see only 3 or 4 hands going up. That is the influence of the digital era. How many of you are not on Twitter or don't follow Twitter? Okay, you have to make your way into Twitter now. There are quite a lot of you. So we are driven by the digital era, the digitization that is happening around us. And there is a lot to pick up from that. Our generation, when we were in college like you, we never had, you know, even the internet. We never had the web age. We used to go to the libraries, take out books, refer, note down, come and work on things. Today, you are given a project. What do you do first? First, what do you, Google it. Google. You know, anything starts with Google. So you want to have somebody ask you for a meaning of a word. You don't go to the dictionary, take it out, refer the pages. You just put the word, meaning of. The next moment it is through. So that is the era we are in, more and more driven by technology and digitization. In this era, everything is at your disposal. You know, whatever you want is available to you. You want to have, you know, something totally, nowadays people, when they get detected, you know, somebody says so-and-so is detected with this disease. First of all, you don't know the spelling of it. Some word you hear. So you are afraid to ask, what is it, where has it impacted him? You come and Google it. Find out what is the disease the person is having. That is how we are, you know, engulfed by this. But there is one thing that is not available to you, is the experiential learning. You know, all these are available to you in whatever form you want, but the experiential learning comes, you know, very handy, and it stays with you all through the life. So watch out, first of all, you should be watching around what's happening. It's not just watching around mechanically, but what is it for you to, the takeaway from any situation, or anything that you get into, or your friend gets into. So experiential learning is very, very important. Observational learning is another thing which is very important. So many things are given in the textbooks. So many lectures, even today I'm talking to you. But unless you get into, you know, observing, understanding the learning sort of observation, you know, small thing, what your professor does, again, there could be some takeaways for different people differently. You know, you move in a group, you do a project, and the way people work, you observe. Maybe there is a how not and how to do. Both can be there. So watch out for your observational learning and watch out for the experiential learning, which is a kind of an intangible thing. The world is driven by intangibles. You know, whatever you acquire, the intangibles always come with you, which is never taught. There is a book, I think the professors will be able to say, what is not taught at Harvard? You have heard of this book? What is not taught at Harvard? There is a book. Like that, what is not taught at IPE? That is what you yourself learn. That is what is not taught at IPE. So it's very important in life, friends, to have experiential and observational learning besides whatever we acquire, and everything getting driven by passion. And one small little thing I would say, stay inspired always. You know, chalo kya karega, ho gaya to ho gaya. It is not that. You have to keep your inspiration always, you know, at the highest level. If you are not inspired, it will be very difficult to put the next step forward. How many of you have heard about Wilma Rudolph? One hand goes up. Anybody else? It's two hands. You have heard about Wilma Rudolph. She was a girl born as the 20th child in a family of 22 children in the US. You can imagine 22 children in a house, and she was the 20th. So 19 children elder to her, and two of them next to her, younger to her. This child, she contracts polio at the age of 3 or whatever, as a young child. And you know, you don't have the right kind of treatment. The elderly children, the senior children, start playing because somebody goes to, you know, you can understand. 19 means at least 19 years. The eldest should be 19 years in that family. She goes to play university football, I mean basketball. Somebody goes for athletics. And poor little girl, she has to just watch them. And somewhere there was somewhere she felt that, you know, will I be like this and what should I do? So the mother took care of her. She used to walk every day, I think 5 or 9 miles to the doctor, to the physiotherapist, to see that this girl gets some treatment and she's at par with the other children, because she has to live with 21 children in the family itself. So she took the efforts of taking her, and she was made to wear very heavy braces and boots. You know, it was very difficult for the child to even put a step forward. And the child grows that way. And she wanted to, she had a, you know, she was having the fire in her to run, which people would laugh at, whatever I have described to you. The girl has heaviest of braces to walk. She's on treatment, she's on physiotherapy, lot of things. But she comes under a coach. The coach says, nothing is impossible for you. And the girl is taught, coached for track events. She starts running and she participates in school events. Small little things happens to her. And the same girl, 1956, Melbourne Olympics, she runs and gets the bronze medal. A girl who was affected with polio, for whom taking one step forward was a big problem, runs the Melbourne Olympics in 1956 and comes home with the bronze medal. Come 1960, the Roman Olympics, she runs the 100 meters, breaks all the record thus far has been created in the Olympics, sets up a new record. She runs the 200 meters, gets the gold medal, runs the 4 into 100, and she gets the gold medal. If a person of such handicap could reach to the level of that kind of an achievement of breaking Olympic records, and anybody who runs and breaks the Olympic record 100 meters is supposed to be the fastest woman or fastest man on earth, and she becomes the fastest woman on earth. It's a very inspiring story for me, because the person who was almost written off, you know, she could have become a scientist, it's okay. She could have become a rocket scientist, it's all okay. But the handicap that would be against you in terms of running an Olympic track event was just broken by her. She's a very, very natural self, and she creates records. Does it not inspire all of us? I think I'm telling story and people are enjoying. See, the best part of it is, it sends in law, it gives out, it oozes with inspiration. Because when, you know, we are in a position to come and do MBA here, enjoy best of things in life, what should be our achievement levels? What should be our aspiration levels? What should be our ambition? It should be much, much, much high, and we should work to achieve. Have you all heard about this Brookings Bridge in US, New York? It's Brookings Bridge, no? Pardon? Brooklyn Bridge, sorry. Brooklyn Bridge, have you heard about it? You have heard, some people say yes, and anyway, you can Google it today, okay? So how it was built, that's a very other fantastic story. The Brooklyn Bridge was started. What I want to tell stories is, these are all real things. If I tell you something from Mahabharata, you may say it is all apocryphal. Who has seen Arjuna? Who has seen Karna? You will ask me. So these are all real life stories which have happened. When Brooklyn Bridge was under construction, the senior, you know, engineer, he dies. So, and it is taken over by the junior person, the son. And one fine day, a huge accident happens. And he is totally paralyzed. The bridge is midway. He is totally paralyzed. What a normal person should have done? He would have given up. Who's, you know, Brooklyn Bridge is a kind of a iconic structure. And to build that is going to be a mammoth task. Halfway, I have suffered such a paralysis, nothing below the neck to the leg, except one finger that will work. Only this part of the body works. Below the neck, nothing else. We would have given up the construction? You are all, nobody's reacting yet. We would have given up, right? But this engineer, what he did was, he would lie on the bed and he developed a language, sign language, only using this finger, and he would tap the wife's hands and give the messages, and she will relay it to the site engineers. What I want to drive home is the level of, you know, how inspired we should be, how passionate we should be. His passion was to see the bridge getting completed. So all of us said we would have given up construction, run around to doctors, see whether from America I go to Europe or I come for Ayurvedic therapy to India, those kind of things. But here the man's passion was such that he decided to develop a code language, and his wife would understand and she would relay the message to the site engineers, and the whole Brooklyn Bridge was completed. So what it all gives us, or what message it gives us, is the impossible can still be achieved if you have the passion and the drive. Yes or no? Sure? The girls are very quiet. Yes? So in life, one needs to stand inspired. Whatever we get, whatever be the assignment, whatever be the project, whatever be the things that we get in life. You can choose your life partner, but you can't choose your boss. You know, it is always, you can choose your life partner, but never the boss. Because you will never know who's going to be your boss. So it is always better that you have the positives, you know, on top, rather than the negatives. Instead of, you know, you don't know who's going to be your boss or who's going to be a project leader. But at the end of the day, you have to live with him or with her. It is better that you always stand inspired. And I'm very sure these kind of stories, I mean, I've not come here to tell you stories, but I just wanted to place before you two difficult persons, people who can't dream to achieve anything in life, the condition of life, the, I would say, whatever you want to call, the destiny was unfair to them, or whatever was unfair to them. Totally people who have been done, I mean, given unfair treatment to start their life, have ended up gloriously. If you see the Brooklyn Bridge today, I'm sure the professors from America who have come here, I mean,